Hello, everyone. I guess I'm live, right on time. Broadcasting live from Greece for the Shiflett Brothers Sculpting Forum, All Star Wednesday Sculpting. So thank you very much, Brandon and Jarrod, for inviting me. It's a big honor for me to be among such company. And yeah, I set up the camera in manual so I can hopefully control the focus because I had it in autofocus and it messes up all the time. So, Brandon, also happy birthday for your birthday. I'm a little nervous, but I guess I'm gonna get rid of the nervousness as we start doing this. So this is just a super sculpty piece that I started recently. It's one of the pieces I'm going to be working on later on, along with a companion piece that I started to. It was a tricky armature to build, and now it's even trickier to get in the deep points all around the sculpture, but yeah, it's going to take some time to finish this one, but it's also enjoyable. So, hi, Laura. And I guess I'm going to try and give you a look around the workshop with just let me set the autofocus on a little bit. My web camera has a cable, just 1 meter cable, so it's going to be tricky to move around the workshop and show you in detail. So I'm just going to get up and try and give you guys a better look. So this is my main sculpting area. That's my doggy. Sorry for the shakiness. Okay. And I have brought a few pieces here on the table to bring in front of the camera and talk a little bit about these pieces, which are from different materials and sculpted in different materials, molded in different materials, and cast in different. So we have polyester resin, we have urethane resin, silicone, and we get a very close at this later. So let's start from there. This corner over there it's very messy because I keep adding stuff in the workshop. So this is where all my screws and bolts are and screwdrivers. This is the main shelf that I intended to use as a working bench, but over the years I found it's better to just put my unfinished sculptures and use it as a storage space mostly. And it goes, yeah, all the way down there. It's busy, it's busy. I have also works from favorite artists in here that inspire me and that I admire. So it's a mixture of my work and other people's work. It's not everything mine. Over there you can see the cabinet with all my reference material, skulls, castings from real animals, and whatever I can find in nature. I get very inspired by looking at these. Over there, you can see in the corner, I have more spray and materials. It's a little bit chaotic in here, but I found my way of working with this chaos over the years. Molds, you can see on the shelf over there, the white molds, plaster jacket mold with silicone inside. Here's a bookshelf with a lot of books that I also use for reference, inspiration, and research. Here are some big silicone pieces on top as well. I have too much coffee, so sorry for the shaky camera. Yeah, more molds, molds, molds. I like the slogan from Smooth On. What are you waiting for? Make it now. And over there is my degassing chamber with the table saw and the grinding wheel. Over there in the corner, I have the water-based clays and the black bags. And that's pretty much it in very. Put the camera back because it's. I ran on the Greek tree. Sorry, guys, I'm having a hard time to check the comments. So, hi, Jarrod, Brandon, JJ, thank and yeah, okay. So now I'm going to bring a few pieces in front of the camera and talk a little bit about each piece, you know, how I worked on it, materials, etc., etc. So yeah, first off, I have this a piece I sculpted in while in Croatia for a festival, IFCC, and I had the time to do a demonstration sculpture at my table where I was sitting with my work. And this is what I came up with. It's oil-based clay, Savant NSP medium. Of course, it had a lot more spikes that I had to remove for take it with me on the plane, and thankfully it survived the travel. So it's yes, not finished. You can see still rake marks on the surface. If I can get it to focus. And the clay at this point is really dry because this is about 4 years old, even more. So Savant NSP has this problem, at least in my workshop. I don't know if it's the extreme heat in the summer, but it tends to lose the oil on the surface and it becomes brittle and dry. So after a lot of years, Savant for me becomes rock hard almost and unworkable on the surface, which is one of the things I don't like too much about Savant, even if it's one of my most favorite clays to work with. So another one, this is I think even older than this piece. So it's again Savant NSP medium oil-based clay. Wait, yeah, this I need to mold at some point, but I didn't mold it because of the little pinchers. I didn't know what to do with the molding, how to work around it. And all these little bumps I made with a syringe, and I had the oil-based clay mixed with solvent to make it like a slurry, put it in a syringe and do, you know, one by one. And this is Munster clay, another oil-based clay, one of my other favorites, a small piece I did on a piece of wood. So this is going to be like I still need to finish it, but yeah, you can see it's not completely finished. This size is more finished. And I have this guy, which is NSP soft. NSP soft. At this point, it has become almost like medium because again, it's sitting on the shelf. Come on. Okay. And the lower teeth is also, I had to cut it in order to mold this piece. So it can be, if you see, it can come out, but it's still not finished, the sculpt. So I'm going to work on the teeth and every little detail. You see, I have just started adding detail on this side. You can still see rake marks, and this side is more refined. And this guy is also not molded because, again, I'm a little lazy, and I'm guessing I will have to build a dividing wall for this piece just because of the ears size and going downwards, which is going to be hard to cast, if you can imagine it upside down. And also harder to come out of the mold. So rain check on this one when I figure out how to do it. Now this is also Munster clay, and this I started digitally in ZBrush and Sculptris. So then I got a 3D print done from the from the model, which looked like this. So you can see a lot of imperfections and lines on the surface. I had to fill up some areas. And this is the as far as I got so far with the detailing of this piece. Mansur Clay is amazing for getting detail, and I have the back, I still have to work on the back. You can see I started this kind of texture, but in order to do it in the whole surface, it will take quite some time. I also use the syringe method with the little bumps that you can see here and there. If it's a bigger bumps, it's easy to do with just a spatula tool and then blend it around and burn it with a fire, and just like the ones I have around the lips, on the brows here. So yeah, this piece is also going to be very bulky, very. So I'm trying to figure out a way to cut it back here so it's not so massive. It doesn't have so much mass. Almost done this one. I'm almost ready to mold it. Here's one piece that I like because it's it's not monster. It's something very much based on human anatomy. I did this for a short film from Stefan Artus, the trying to remember the Faun of Hillwood, something like that, I think. Hope, yeah, I can see mistakes now that I'm looking at the hair work is horrible. I cannot sculpt hair yet. I have to practice on that. I also had two horns that I cast separately. Yeah, the Faun of Hillwood. Then I get this guy. This is cast in polyester resin. It was sculpted in oil-based clay, Savant NSP medium, and cast in this particular piece is polyester resin. So you see the lovely translucency that it has. And the base color was actually like what you see here. I just added little darker tones with a brush, or not even airbrush at this for this piece. Just brass work. And I made this little because of the nudity. You can see the size. He also has a weapon and a decapitated human head on the other hand, but for this piece, not there. So yeah, this is one of my favorite pieces. And I based this one on the anatomy tools anatomy figure, you know, so it's exactly the same proportions. I had it next to me when I was making the armature to make sure that the proportions are correct, you know, where the width of the shoulders, where the elbows go, where the knees and everything. And here we have a silicone piece. This also began as a three digital model. And I got it 3D printed, same process, molded the print, made a clay pour out of it, detailed all the surface, so I get all the skin detail that I wanted. But because it's silicone, it hides a lot of the detail. It has to be painted right to bring all this detail back on. I did a lot of hair punching for this one, tiny little white hair. And it's cast in dragon skin 20 platinum silicone. It's a solid piece of silicone. And the mold was also dragon skin, same silicone, so it didn't have inhibition problems. This is an older super sculpted piece. This is a baked original version that I molded. It's a very skinny alien. One thing with Super Sculpey Pink original is may look okay when you're sculpting it and it's looking cool with the translucency, but once you cast it in a opaque material, you see all the imperfections of the sculpture. And I have to pay extra attention that everything is refined as best as I can before I mold it. Because it looks good, but then you see it in gray resin, and I can see all kinds of imperfections that I don't like. This is another silicone piece. Also, guys, if you have comments, oh shit, there's so many comments. They were not moving, so thank you. Thanks, everyone, for joining me. If you have any questions about materials, write them in the comments. I'll try to answer as soon as possible. You're so lazy. Thank you, everyone, each and every one of you for joining. So this is a silicone piece another piece I sculpted in oil-based clay, made a silicone mold, and in the silicone mold I cast Ecoflex 0010, which is a very soft silicone. I intended to make this move, you know, like a puppet, like you see here, with just a piece of, it's like a loop tool that I inserted on the back, going all the way to his lower lip. And yeah, that's again hair punched, all the little white hair. The eyes are also silicone for this piece, so it's all smooth and hollow up here. The chicken. Now this is the last piece I got to mold after working on it for almost a year. I mean, I finished it, but I left it sitting there and I couldn't finally take the decision to mold it. So now this is the first cast that I got out of the mold. You can see the size. It has a lot of skin texture. It was sculpted in NSP medium, the green one, and painted with acrylics, both brushes and a little bit of airbrush. A lot of the spatter technique, where I just do this with the brush to make the freckle-like texture on the paint job. It's I like this piece because it's recent. Here's the blank version. This is going to a new home very soon. So it's, I clean up all the seam line, and then I primer it with a gray primer spray. Here's a polyester resin version of the same guy you saw earlier with the silicone. So this is the first casting out of the mold that I did in polyester, but it's not focused. There you go. It's missing the chicken. This is my hair, by the way, from when I had long hair when I was a teenager. And this I made because the hair is very crudely stuck on the surface because it's resin, and I wanted him to have some hair like I did in the sculpture. Could be a fisherman or something like that. This one here is an old piece, older, I don't know what the year was it. A cormorant. I used the reference from a book, from pictures. Only this side is, again, most of my unfinished sculptures, I refine one side and the other one is, it's not so worked. So this is a more refined one. It's just a bust. And again, this is a NSP medium. As you can see, it's pretty hard. this another recent piece. I'm using a June's Anatomy tiger head, which is amazing to use as reference, and it's also 3D object that you. It's the best kind of reference for me. Of course, it has a lot of issues, and with proportions, again, I screwed up. I think the eyes, the muzzle is too fat. I don't know, something's not quite working for me, so I kind of lost interest for this piece. I'm hoping the next time I give it a try, it will be better, more accurate. This is a Le Betuche, again from Savant, but it's a very soft, very sticky clay, almost like water clay consistency, but it's oil-based clay, so you don't have to cover it up. And also with this one, you cannot soften the surface with fire, with a torch. It doesn't melt, it just gets softer. And another one, this is polyester resin. I made a tribute to Coco, the gorilla. It's a hollow casting filled with urethane foam, and this is urethane resin. I did roto casting by hand because I still don't have a roto casting machine. And yeah, the backside, as you can see, is full of rake marks. But I'm happy with the result. Some people told me it looked like Coco, so I'm good with that. Yeah, this is a latex hollow piece. I didn't feel it yet, and it's quite thin, but it's holding its shape even if you leave it like this, and it's moving nicely as well. So this is latex painted with stretchy paint. This is how it's called. It's a paint specifically made for painting latex, and it's the best I used from any kind that I've used so far. Problem is I cannot find it anymore, so these paints online, so I have to find an alternative. And painted with these colors, I used a lot of airbrush for this one, for the modeling and some very subtle paint transitions, color transitions. The eyes are painted with just a pen, a brush, sorry, and covered with 5-minute clear epoxy for the glossiness. A trick I learned from Jordu Sell, master of mask making. So yeah, that's a perfect piece. Here's another hollow polyester piece, again, filled with foam, 3 layers of urethane resin, roto casting. And then painted again, same techniques, acrylics, thinned down with Azax. I use Azax, which is a window cleaner. Some people like to use alcohol, it works as well. But I get it. Silicone mold. And this was sculpted in a water-based clay during my workshop that I did here on my workshop last May. I like this piece as well. I used a digital model that I made as reference for it. Let me check the comments. Hi, Tomek. thank you very much. Catherine, I do use a mirror a lot of the times, especially if I move too much on one side and the other side is still not refined and I have to do exactly the same secondary and tertiary forms on the other side. I definitely put a mirror behind my sculpt and I just copy what I see, you know, from the other side. Thank you, Chiara Bartoli. For the eyes, for the small pieces, I mostly use paint brushes. Just paint brushes because they are so small and I cannot get in there with an airbrush. Not yet. I'm not so good with the airbrush. I use it only for if I want smooth transition of color, and when I want to do veins, you know, something that's really subtle, and for a few other things. But mostly I use brushes and sponges to make it look like it's done with an airbrush, you know, to scrape away some of the excess paint. Thank you, John Payne. This you in the polyester compared to polyurethane, Sebastian Potts. Yeah, I prefer polyester, to be honest. I know it's a toxic material and it smells bad. I cannot work with it in my workshop. But I do all the castings for polyester outside because the ventilation system here is not too good. So urethane resin, I don't like the fact that it comes out opaque, first of all, the one I use. It doesn't have any translucency. And it gets yellow with the UV radiation from the daylight anyway. If you leave something in the daylight, you can see it changing color. You can get rid of this problem by just spraying the whole thing with a base color before you start painting it, and don't use the material color as a base. And also it's cheaper, polyester is much cheaper than urethane. I can find it locally here, and it has this nice translucency that I can control the amount of translucency for each piece. I can control the base color if I want it to be flesh-like, if I want to be off-white. So I use both. When I do castings of the full body maquettes, I use urethane because it's very low viscosity and it gets in there without, I don't have a pressure pot. So all my castings are done with gravity castings. So yeah, these are the main differences between polyester and polyurethane. Let me get something else here. Oh, this piece is also EcoFlex. It's an old piece that I did, and again I have added some nice movement. But it's really hard to control with one thing. I have all these levers back here, so this is the snarl, and this controls the mouth open if I push it, and these two are for the brows, but they're not working so well, if you can see. Yeah, it's supposed to get angry or something, but the whole eye is moving because the eyes are also silicone. Let me see. So I think I sold all the pieces that I had on the table. Oh, there's another one, very small. It was 3D printed, made in Sculptris, the Sculpt. Let's fucking focus. Hate it. I need to detail this and mold it at some point. It's still quite rough. I have added some detail on the face. If it will focus. Yeah. I still work to do on this one. Here's an example of a raw unpainted polyester casting. You see this nice translucency that it has. I love this. When I don't know, I believe it adds one more level of realism on the pieces. I know not all animals or creatures are translucent, but to me it gives, you know, just this extra. Let me check the comments a little bit. What are your top three most used tools when sculpting? Okay, I'll show you my favorite tools. I have a selection of tools down here. These are the tools I use for small scale sculpture, like the busts I showed you. One of my favorites of all time is this one, which is like a. This is used to work with copper sheets to do engraving or something like that. When I bought it, that's what the purpose of this tool was, but for me it's perfect for sculpting. Used as a spatula tool, I can do add secondary forms with this, you know, just take taking like that if it sticks, and I put it wherever I want, blend it around. It's a little similar to the Takayuki Takeya spatula tools that he promoted recently. It's the same kind of, you know, not too sharp on the edge. It's nice and rounded and not too sharp or pointy. So I can do lines like this for texture work. I do the pores for small pieces by just and turning it around so that the pores also have a direction. I guess I'm gonna show this on a sculpture later on. So this is one. This is another one, a simple saw blade rake tool. One edge is circular, the other one is a little more flat. The teeth are sanded down, which is very important if you don't want to have little crumbles of clay all around your sculpture. And of course, I have a lot of handmade, as this rake is also homemade tool, this one as well, another rake. I do many, many, many rake tools. I have all sizes, all different kinds, you know, from the finest to the more coarser ones. But my favorites are the saw blade ones. You know, you can find, this is also saw blade, but very, very tiny. I use this as a last pass of rake tool before I start smoothing the surface. And this one I made myself again, guitar string on one side, and the other side I had a piece of wire that I flattened and made again another little spatula like this, which are really handy. So then when I found that I can make my own spatulas, I went crazy with it, and I made all kinds of different spatulas, different sizes, different shapes, to accommodate my style of sculpting and the size of sculpting that I do. Now let me bring something else on the table to show some examples of how I do certain stuff. Well, now when I work with Super Sculpey, I have a different process of doing it. So because I know especially the soft grade like this one, the original pink Super Sculpey, is very soft when it's fresh. This one that I use for this is not very fresh, but it's not too hard either. So you can see right out of the box, it's quite soft. And if you manipulate it a little bit in your hands, it becomes almost like a chewing gum. So the way I found to make it easier for me to sculpt with this material is as soon as I have the armature done, I cover the armature with just a very thin layer of Sculpey, the whole piece. Very thin, you know, you can almost see the wire under the Sculpey. So, and then I bake that with either a heat gun, as enough to get it hard and rigid, or I put it in the oven, and then I have a steady armature to work on and add, you know, all the muscle groups on top of the already baked Sculpey surface. So if you see on this sculpture, there are areas, I think, behind the knee. Yeah, here this, it's baked Sculpey, and here starts the fresh one, where you can still work on it. And that's, and the hands, I stop on the wrist, because I want to play a little bit with the proportions of the hands, the pose, and I never make armature wires for fingers and stuff like that. Because, as I said, I'm lazy and I want to see results very fast. Thank you, Olga. Thank you very much. Thank you, Jarrod, Ryan. Thanks, everyone, for joining. I hope it's informative. Again, any questions you might have, put them in the comments. I'm reading every now and then. Yeah, sorry about the camera. I'm doing my best. Now I have it on manual focus, so I can, depends on what piece I bring and how close I bring it to the camera, I can control the, yeah, right there. So I'm going to do a little bit of detailing work on this piece. Show you how I use another very tiny spatula tool that I made with a steel wire. This is steel, spring steel wire that I burned it until it becomes red hot, and then hammer it on a, on another hammer, because I don't have an anvil, and hammer it until it becomes flat. Then I make the desired curve that I want, and then a lot of sanding on nail sandpapers. These are great for making mirror finish polishing, like this stuff. It has many different sandpapers. So yes, I made this with this side, and then the other side is even more narrow. So you can see I take little pieces like that. I stick it where I want, and the good thing with sculpting is it stays where you put it, because it has nice adhesive properties. So for instance, I add these three pieces, and then I use a little ball tool to blend the edges and make it as pointy as I want it, how big I want to be. And again, you know, observing from nature is key if you are a creature or character designer and doing organic stuff. I've seen a lot of animals that have little bumps like this, and for some reason it gives nice fleshy look to the something like that. Here I added a little smaller ones, and the same process I did here with just adding here with bigger balls, and I blend them in with a bigger ball like this one. Another thing with super sculpt is you have to have super clean hands, because it gets black and dirty. And because now I touched all these other sculptures, my hands are dirty again. And still the back is still not finished, it's not even close. But yeah, obviously this is a side I worked more on. And the face I have changed, I don't know how many times so far, until I find the face that I'm happy with. This is not the one, but it's just the current face. I have to try many options, because you never know, you know. Sometimes it's for the better, sometimes it's for the worse. I try to keep trying things. I need to clean my hands a little bit. Thanks, Eric Sosa, John Payne. It sucks because I cannot see the comments when they start, so I don't know which piece everyone's talking about. I don't use anything iron swepstone to make the fresh sculpt bond to the hard. Sometimes it doesn't stick too well, but I just blend the edge, and it kind of sticks there until I put more and more, and then it's trapped inside, so I have no problem with that. That's how I do it. I heard from Paul Komoda, I think, that he sanding a little bit the area that he wants to stick the fresh sculpey onto, and that helps. But again, super sculpey, I've only used, you know, 4-5% of my sculpting work. Mostly is done on oil-based clays and water-based clay. I'm just now starting to get the hang of super sculpting, and I'm liking it the more I use it. So cool, fine. Hi Timo, thank you. Greetings from Greece. So, what to do now? I'm gonna bring the other creature. This is at the point now where I'm working all around the piece. I don't like the size of the head. It's, I think it's a little too big. Let me focus the camera again. Yep. Yeah, the head is very, very generic at this point. These were supposed to be mandibles, but after trying different things, I decided to take them on the back. And at this point, I'm still not sure if it's working well for me. This is one of the pieces where I'm like, I'm blind, you know, I cannot determine if I like it or not. It's definitely something different just from the armature complexity. But yeah, it still needs a lot of work on the, I use firefly larva for doing the exoskeleton. So it still needs, you know, little things like, and it's, this piece is not very ideal for a sculpture demo because of its position, and you know, if I hold it like this, it's going to be hard for you guys to see what I'm doing. Added some nice details on the back here, but yeah, it's still very rough, and this is never going to get molded for sure, not from me anyway. Thank you guys, thanks everyone for putting in the comments. I'll try to make it as informative and enjoyable for you as I can. So what I was thinking is maybe sculpt on the on either this one or do some detailing work on this guy, the because it's oil-based clay and the surface is nice and horizontal, so I don't have focusing problems like with this one. The head is here and the tail is here. So I'll swap this, bring this one here. I'll show you a little bit how I go about detailing the surface when it's at this point. Let me focus. Yeah. Okay, I can use many, many different tools for adding pores and little lines. I use this. This is another favorite tool of mine, which one side is just like a rounded piece of wire, and the other one is more pointy, where you can do super fine adjustments, especially for the eyelids. So I take the rounded side, and I do this kind of thing, like wavy lines, and crossing one another. It's a standard direction that I use for the wrinkles and pores, and this comes from observation, observing real people, real faces, old faces. And I do the detailing in layers as well. I do almost everything in layers because I found that doing everything with layers adds more realism for some reason. I go over it with a tiny rake tool. Now, I'll use the tool I told you about, but sometimes I use this tool for making pores, which is another homemade tool. I took the shape of a found a tool online that I like the shape of, and I just copied the shape on with the spring steel wire. So this is also good for lines, doing bigger lines, and also for making the pores, like so. And I'm twisting the tool as I move around, again, to give the pores direction and not be just dots of and once I go over that with the little fire, you see how easy it is to blend all these together, soften them down a bit, and make them more round and natural looking. So I have this tool. It's basically a flame torch, but it has this very convenient tip. This is called Dremel Versa tip, because it has various different tips that you can add on the top. I only use this one, which is like a very mini heat gun. So you can see the inside. It doesn't produce any flame, but it melts the clay. You can control how much you melt the clay. Where with fire, straight flame, sometimes you melt more than you want. So this is also great if you want to go, you know, inside the mouth where the area is really small and you don't want to burn the teeth. Yeah, you see the. And you can go much more and everything is gone back to where it was. Another way I use this tool is like to make pores, but more like lines, you know, for areas that the skin is stretched or compressed. Also, this is a very handy tool that I got from Effect Studio. Goran made these tools. Yeah, obviously you can see it's for doing textures. This is big for this size of piece. I'll give you a little demonstration in the back. I already did it. So when I use this piece, I don't do that because this creates, you know, the same. Where if I do that, it's more random. One goes over the other, and it needs a lot of layers to do it a lot of times to create a nice natural feel to it. Another tool I use a lot for skin texturing is the scratchy. I call them scratchy tools. I learned all about these tools during my time in Weta Workshop from master sculptors like David Menk, Jamie Beswarik. And I learned so much just by working along these guys for 11 months over there for tool making, techniques, sculpting. You know, I was like a sponge getting all the information I could from looking at these guys' work. And thank you very much, everyone. Reading the comments right now. Welcome, Vogue Sadan. Love your work, man. Hi, Gilles. Hi, man. Gilles. I hope I'm bad with pronouncing names. The rollers are great. Expensive, though. Yeah, but you only get them once, so as long as you don't break them or lose them. Giovanni Luigi, when do you make a head? Do you start from basic shapes? How do you organize the beginning? That's a good question, because most of the times I design straight away in clay. It varies a lot with me. Sometimes I have a vague idea of what I want to do. For instance, I want to do an alien with a long neck. So that's the clues I have. Other times I have something very specific in my mind, like I want to do an ape. So then I also use reference to get the proportions right and get some inspiration. Other times I just have a piece of like this base. I use a plaster, a very quick and easy way to make bases for my busts. Like this is, I use a ball of plaster, really thick plaster, not runny or anything. And I stick a big screw with the hexagonal side on the bottom, embed it in the plaster before the plaster sets. I leave it to set, sticking up in a 90 degree angle, and then it's, I wrap some wire around that and start building up the basic forms, mostly where the shoulders are going to end, and based on the shoulders then I build the neck and the size of a head that I want to have. So this piece doesn't have any armature. The screw, as you can see, stops somewhere in here. So all this is supported just by the clay, straight clay. And if you're using Munster clay, I would suggest that you use armature for the neck as well, because I have examples here from Munster clay pieces that I've done, and I didn't use armature for necks or hands. You know, everything in the summer where it gets around 35 degrees in here, everything bends, you know, and changes poses and heads fall down. And so I learned from my mistakes to, when I'm using Munster clay, because it has a much lower melting point, to use an armature to support everything that needs to get supported. What else can I bring to work? Bring this guy back. Let me know if you want to see something specific that you saw. Yeah, so you, Annie. Yeah, Jamie Beswark is, I believe, one of my top favorite artists. I don't know, it's just his style and realism that he puts in fantasy is amazing. Hello, Scott. Leslie, what did I use for the eyes? Sometimes I make the eyes myself. Like, I'm gonna show you. I'm gonna bring a big piece now. Bear with me. I don't know if it's gonna fit in the frame. Yeah. So this is this eyes I made myself, again with clear polyester. I can take one out if you like. I like to play with the eyes of a silicone character. So it's the way I do it is, I have a silicone mold. Imagine a silicone mold, the negative space of this ball. And I just pour a few drops of clear polyester to just fill the one third of the, or one fourth of the mold. And once this is dry, the clear part, I paint on the back of the clear part. I paint the dot on the center, and then some thin down blue. And then I scratch a little bit. You can see some white lines in there. I scratch a little bit to create, you know, fine little lines. And then I pour the same polyester with just a little bit of white in there to make the white part. And because it's all polyester and the same kind of polyester, it's nice, and you don't have separation here between the clear and the white, where I use different materials other times and it didn't cure very well. I wanted to make this a hand puppet, but yeah, I started putting some mustache, if you can see. But this big piece is very big and heavy, so it would take me a lot of time and patience to do the hair punching, which I don't have, unfortunately. Unless, you know, I work on it for months and months. So let me take this back. Here's another latex piece. This is latex filled with insulation foam. Let me focus. Painted with acrylics, the sculpt was done with water-based clay. The eyes are painted for this one. It's just latex. I painted the color I want, and then I add the 5-minute epoxy to give this nice shine to it. Same for the teeth. They're sculpted, just painted to look nice and shiny. And this piece I sculpted to have decoration in my workshop. So it's, again, you know, very simple to sculpt, easy to sculpt, and easy to mold when it's, you know, just a half face. Yeah, I still like this piece. What do you use to color the polyester? I use polyurethane pigments that I get online from stores like Formex, Moldlife, you know, any effect supply store will have them. I mostly use the white polyurethane pigment, which works great with polyesters as well. And I also have a red one. So if I want to make a flesh color casting, I put white and just a few drops of red, and you get this color, which looks almost like super sculpting. This polyester, but you see, because I put wires in the legs for support, the wires came on the surface, and this is a defect casting. Because the way I would paint this is by just adding the darker tones. Whenever I paint translucent material, I just add the darker tones, nothing lighter than the base that already has. That way you maintain the translucency of the material. Where in polyurethane, when the piece is opaque, I have to paint the base color first, a white color or something like that, and then add all the darker tones one by one. Thank you very much, Luis. It's always good to hear that. Thank you, Sebastian. Yes, thanks to the Shiflett Brothers for making this happen. It's one of the main reasons I'm still on Facebook, to be honest. It's the Shiflett Brothers Sculpting Forum, because, you know, how the algorithms of Facebook are screwed up and no one sees our work anymore. But with this community that you guys created, it's awesome, because we get to exchange ideas and a lot of inspiration. So yeah, thank you for making this happen. So I'm going to continue a little bit, I think, work on this piece. Try to do some of this stuff that I have on this side. Try to copy it here because it's completely different. Yes, Sebastian, I prefer the polyester for some projects. For some projects, polyurethane is better, as I said, because of the low viscosity, because I can do it in the workshop. I know it still has toxic fumes, but I can at least wear a mask in here and do it without stinking the whole place with polyester smell. Thanks, Jared. Thanks. Yeah, painting is for me the other 50% to bring a concept that you have in your mind to fully completed. And to be honest, I really enjoy painting my pieces when I have the first cast out of a mold. After that, when, for instance, some people want to buy the painted version and I have to do the same paint job over and over again, you know, it becomes like a chore for me. But and because I know I have to produce the same exactly result as the first casting that I painted with so much enthusiasm. And yeah, it gets a little tiring for me to paint, and that's because I'm mostly a sculptor and not a painter. But yeah, to give another level of realism to my pieces, I have to paint them to look convincing to my eyes. Tomek, Aris, what do you think at first when you start sculpting your creatures? Well, it depends. For this one, I just knew it's going to be an alien, and I knew it's going to be in Super Sculpey. So after that, you know, once a lot of what the character becomes is based on the proportions of your armature. So because the proportions of this one were human-like, you know, two legs, two arms, standing on two legs, it was, you know, I didn't have much choice. I couldn't make it something. So I work along these lines with what the armature is dictating me. Other times I have something in my mind before I sculpt. Like I said, I have a vague idea of something or something very specific. And not most of the times I don't stick to the plan, and because I'm very compulsive, and sometimes if something doesn't work, I'm willing to make radical changes until I have something that inspires me to continue. You know, I want to see results and fast. So this is a good and a bad thing for me. I don't have much patience. So that's why I start a lot of pieces, but I don't finish as much pieces. That's why the shelf on the bag is so full of stuff. What do you think? Maybe there's an alternative to polyester. I'm sure there are, not sure, there are urethane resin that it's clear. So you can pigment it and get the exact same result. But I cannot find this locally here. So urethane is already expensive. And if I order it online in big quantities like I do with polyester, I get 25 kilos containers. So that's the reason why I do not order. And I also get my urethane locally. So I try not to order stuff from abroad, especially when it's heavy stuff, because the shipping costs are crazy. So alternative for polyester that doesn't smell here in Greece, I haven't found yet. Something that has no translucency. For if you search in Smooth On, has what it's called, the easy smooth cast 325, I think, something like that. It's a clear version where you can pigment it. It doesn't smell, and it has all the properties of urethane resin. Thank you, Crystal. Thank you for the support as well. Thank you, Martin. Yes, I am going to announce the next two guest sculptors at the end. That's correct. Very excited for both of these names. Renzo Lacuzzi, did you plan the position of the creature muscles in creatures with long or short extremities? I'm not sure I understand your question, Renzo. I don't know if you're speaking about the pose or the... Can you rephrase, please? I don't have a website, Brian. You can contact me directly, either here on Facebook with a message or in my email, but preferably here on Facebook. And I have a price list for everything that I have available to order. I could send you the price list and you can order directly from me if you want. To smooth the surface on Super Sculpey, Mace Stark, I use solvents because obviously I cannot use heat because it will bake it, will make it hard. So I have to use, first of all, a lot of rake tools, different courses. I started with a big one about this size. I don't know if you can see. I'll bring it closer. Focus. Yeah, so I use rake tools, all the different sizes. The final one that I use is the guitar string rake, something like this. Thank you, JJ, for the wonderful tools, by the way. It's a little dirty from this is maybe a little too small. I cannot even see the lines. But yeah, I use rake tools down to the tiniest one. And when I make sure that my forms are nice and rounded and not with any hard edges or hard shadows, then I use a brush, hard hair brush, like pig hair brush, you know. And I use either this is in Greek, but it's gasoline for cleaning purposes, you know, to clean stains on your clothes, and it smells like gasoline, and it melts the surface quite well, a lot of it, and also evaporates really fast. So I mostly use this one for smoothing the surface on the Super Sculpey. For oil-based clays, I use a mix of gasoline with I call it paraffin oil. It's basically some black containers, like black plastic bottles with barbecue starter liquid. They also use it for that. It works just like a white spirit. It melts the clay a lot and stays on the surface a lot. It doesn't evaporate as fast. So I use a little bit of that and a little bit of gasoline mixed together in a little container to go around the surface with a brush as a final polishing. Sometimes when I do that, then I go on top to add a little extra, you know, detail, surface detail. But you drag on the phone. Sorry, Tomek, I don't know what profile is, or I control forms in my creatures using a lot of pushing. With Super Sculpey, I use a lot this tool. But first of all, I use my fingers. But now, because my fingers are dirty, I don't want to put any new material. I make little worms like that. Depends on which place I want to add it. So, for instance, a place where I want it to be, I might do some blending with my finger. And then I use either a big ball like this one or a spatula tool or whatever is working best for you to blend this with the surrounding clay, so you don't get have different sizes as well. And the armature is not stuck on the piece of wood, because I wanna sometimes take it off and play with the pose a little bit, slight little changes, nothing dramatic. And also, when it comes to bake it, I have to maybe put it on a smaller base to fit in the oven, because I have a small toaster oven for baking Super Sculpey and warming up oil-based clays. And I also have a microwave oven, mostly for warming up clays a little faster, even though it's not ideal for me. I prefer use a good old-fashioned oven toaster. Does the polyester resin not have, I don't know. Now, polyester resin is a very tricky material to learn to work around it. It has to do a lot with room temperature that you're working your material in. In the summer, you need to put 1% catalyst. And in the winter, I found that 2% is ideal, because you know, the temperature is much lower. So also to get rid of the crocodiling problem, which is, you know, sometimes polyester starts to set from the inside to the outside. So first the inside sets and shrinks a little bit. So all the surface of the sculpt detaches from the surface of the mold, leaving some unwanted marks like crocodile skin. That's why they call it crocodiling. And the way to not have this problem is to I put the silicone molds in the oven as well for at 50 degrees Celsius for around 15 minutes. So the mold is nice and hot. Also the polyester I put in front of a heater, covered with plastic wrap, of course, to make it much more low viscosity, because polyester is, the colder it is, the thicker it is. So when I work in the winter, I have to do this whole process for each polyester casting. I have to heat up the mold, heat up the polyester, and then mix the catalyst in and pour quickly. And most of the times I get a very good casting without any crocodile. It's also a matter of demolding at the right time, because if you leave it for too long in there, it's almost inevitable that you get these issues. Thank you, Luis. Greetings. Thank you. Thank you from Canada. Gasoline, yes. Shit, 1 hour is already passed. 1 hour and 15 minutes. Yes, it's amazing that we can do this. One of the good things with technology is I could never imagine doing this when I was just starting out, you know, and first bought my PC computer. Christophile. Thank you, Adrian. You're too kind. Any advice to avoid bubbles when casting? Yes. I do gravity casting because, as I said, I don't have a pressure pot. So you can, to avoid bubbles, sometimes you have to work on the mold to make it bubble proof, you know, to have air vents. For instance, let me just get something here. This is the original of the Barilla that I, as I said, molded recently, and only one is left. You see this little piece of wire that I added here, and I had more wires coming from each finger joining to this wire. Same on the other hand. He lost all the fingers while demolding. So these are here because I know when I'm going to cast this piece, and because it's going to be gravity casting, the piece is going to be, the negative space of the mold will be like that. So you can imagine the level of the resin coming up if these wires were not here, and which translate into holes when the silicone mold is made, then the air has this way to escape and come up to the base with no problem. So when I'm pouring and I see on the top of the mold from this little hole that the resin comes out, I know that I got the full hand without any bubbles. For instance, if I didn't have this, the hand would stop here, because, you know, the air would just get trapped in here. You cannot feel this without having. So one way is that. Another way is the angle that I use when I cast. So for instance, imagine that this is the negative space, and you can see the back is where I cut the silicone. This is messed up because the silicone was bad and shrunk a lot. So I hold the mold like this first, because I know if I pour it like that, straight, I get a lot of bubbles here, here, everything that's hanging down when you see it from this angle, like these tips here, will get air bubbles. And that's why I use the mold holding it like that. I pour a little bit, and as I see the level of resin coming up, I slowly start to bend it until it comes up to the base, and I feel it like this. And then I also vibrate the piece sometimes. And again, you see here, this guy had an air bubble on the problematic spot here. This side was good. And then I fill it with some super sculpey pink, because it also had translucency. And I bake it with the Dremel tool that I saw earlier, the mini heat gun. So it becomes nice and hard, and also maintains some translucency. So when I paint this, it will be invisible. And of course, there are many, many other tricks that I am still learning. The more I do castings and molding, the more I learn how to do it better and bubble free. But eventually, I think I'm going to have to buy a pressure pot and make my life easier and faster. Thank you, Scott. Thank you, James. Thank you, Louis. Everyone, thank you very much. I'm glad you're enjoying it. Thank you, Giovanni. If I have any advice to make a natural and credible character. Well, it depends on the style of work you like to do. I, for instance, what I'm trying to do with my work is bring realism into fantasy, mostly. That's the kind of work I like. That's why I like the work of George Ussel, Casey Love, Steve Wang, you know, all these guys that are great at detailing, as well as painting, as well as the forms are beautiful. You know, all this combined gives a certain amount of believability to a character or a creature, even if it's something completely out of the imagination. Of course, it has to be always based on real life elements, you know, otherwise, you know, you cannot imagine something that you don't know. So it's as simple as that. So a lot of research and studying anatomy and studying real life by just observing very strongly, observing something, looking at it, try to figure out why it looks like that, why it works like that, what's the material it's made of, if it's soft, if it's hard, and incorporate that into your sculpture. I found that for me, the use of rake tool, which makes the shadows nice and soft, like you see the shadow on the shoulder here on the deltoid. It's nice and soft shadow. You don't see any hard shadows or imperfections, which automatically make it look artificial. So if you see nature, you will see sharp edges and sharp, but it's also, I don't know, it's hard to explain. But yeah, I try to look at nature as much as possible. And when I was starting out, mostly I got influenced by other artists' work, because I saw the finished results and I said, that's what I want to do. That's what the kind of result I want to get in my work. And then as the years pass, and I don't want to get influenced too much by other people's styles, although it's again inevitable. That's how my personal style is accomplished. It's just a combination of the things I like, even if it's in nature or other artists' work. And it comes out subconsciously, you know, a lot of the times. So sometimes it's more obvious, sometimes it's less, but we all get inspired by something, you know. I don't know if I answered your question. Hope I did. I don't use a pressure pot, Sebastian, but I'm looking to the possibility of getting one soon. Okay. I do some lessons about sculpting mostly. Basically, I never teach anything else other than sculpting. And I wouldn't be comfortable teaching molding. I can tell everyone that asks me how I do it, but it's in no way the professional way to do it or how the professionals do it. Besides, I'm not a mold maker. I do it out of necessity because you know, that's how I learned to do it, and now it's more like a habit. But no, I don't teach how to cast. I do teach how to sculpt and how I go about sculpting things like this, which is a full body creature maquette over a wire armature, or simple busts like in oil-based and water-based clay. Thank you, Scott. Thank you very much. How would you go about making weapons for your characters? For example, guts from Berserk or Cloud from... I only made weapon one time for this orc character, and I have it here. So I sculpted this out of, this is the original, actually, the Super Sculpey Firm, the hard one. And I overbaked it, I think, because you see little bumps, but they added to the texture. So this was just one piece over a piece of wire that I had. I added some Super Sculpey. And then I did the two-part mold. You can see the line. Two-part mold, the pouring is done from the back side, and then I sand it off. And in order to attach it to the orc's hand, I have to cut it, insert a wire in the orc's hand, the way it is. The way I have made the design is to, he's already holding, as you can see, a little piece. So, you know, the back half, if I drill the hole here, goes and sticks in there, and it eventually looks like he's holding it like that. The same for the decapitated head on the other side. I have another hole where his hair is going in, and it looks like it's holding the hair. And for size comparison. There's an organic side to the way shapes flow into one another. I can see it and you can sculpt it. I'm glad to hear that because, you know, as I said, mostly it happens subconsciously. I just know the kind of result I want to get. And I'm going until it looks like something I had in mind before I do it. You know, it's kind of hard to put it in words, how it works, but. How do you know where to place the seams on your mold when cutting it open? The seams. I do two kinds of molds. I do one piece mold, which is the standard process for my busts. Like for this one, when I finish the sculpture, I cover the whole piece with a brass on silicone mold. So I do a couple of layers with straight silicone, so I get all the surface texture, and then I add a few more layers to get the desired thickness of the mold with a thixotropic agent, which makes the silicone paste like. And then once this is done, I create the supporting mother mold jacket, how they call it. I use plaster for that, so I roughly find the higher spot to make a front piece and a back piece just to support the silicone. Then I open the plaster once it's set and I start cutting the silicone in zigzag motion up to here. I think depends on how big ears it has or how easy it is to demold. And that's how I do my molds. One piece silicone, one slit on the back, and I open it like comes out like this. So I don't have any seam lines to correct here. For the full body ones like this, I had to lie them down when the sculpt was done. I already draw with a marker where I want the dividing wall to come. And then I just filled it with clay. I have pictures in my albums with the process of molding this piece. Again, with vents, air vents going from the hands to the base. And it comes out nice and bubble free. Also, the chin has a problem for this guy because you can see it goes up. So I had one more wire going from the chin to the body. And like that. Airbrushing. I talked a little bit about airbrushing. I'm nowhere near as good as some people are with the airbrush. I try to use it when it's necessary for me, not to just because I have an airbrush, I will use the airbrush for everything. It makes things quicker, definitely, sometimes. I use an Iwata HPC8. And with this one, I do pretty much everything. You know, I have another cheaper one, which I use if I want to do a big surface, cover a big surface of color. It's a gravity feed, double action, I think it's called. Yeah, which with also control the air pressure here, which is very, very useful. If I want to do a spatter technique, I have very little air pressure. And this, when I do it like that, it throws the paint like freckles, like little dots. I also use it if I want to do modeling in the skin, for masks mostly. When I'm painting busts, let me bring another finished bust, for example. So this piece has a lot of airbrush. It's not finished. The paint job is not finished. You can see the blue on the back, the smooth transition. This I had to do with airbrush. You can do it with brush as well, but nothing beats the airbrush when it comes to, you know, subtle things and smooth transitions of colors. So I use the airbrush for this, and all the rest is done with small brushes and go inside all the crevices and make them pop out again with the paint job to complement basically the sculptural forms with color, so it looks good even with flash photography. That's the way I go about painting. When nature, sometimes what it does is trying to hide the forms and disguise them for camouflage reasons. I don't paint like nature, obviously, because I want my forms to pop out and to complement them. So I do this kind of painting where it's not too much vibrant patterns and stuff that alter the appearance of the form. Some people can do amazing results. I just don't have the patience to do paint jobs like the ones Casey Love, Steve Wang, Jordi Sell does. It just takes too much time for me. And as I said, I tend to lose interest if I'm not. Sometimes one in the hundred, I will put a little extra effort in the paint job and try and do something different. But most of the times it's simple paint jobs, grounded to reality, earthy colors. Maybe I can bring something else here. Just a second. Yes, this is cast in polyester resin, again, hollow cast, silicon mold, one piece. The slit of the mold is on the back. It's practically invisible because it was, I think, one of the first castings. Yeah, you can see a little bit where the tearing is here. And it just paints beautifully. Polyester also, I forgot to say that it holds the paint much, much better than urethane does. I found that if I scratch urethane casting after I paint it, even though I have secured the paint job, if I do this with my finger, the paint rubs off, where in polyester it just becomes one with the material. I don't know why and how this happens. Even if I don't secure the paint job with clear acrylic. And zombies, again, is a nice subject for me because it's part fantasy, part realism. You know, you also get to do anatomy study and you also get to have fun with the craziness. How to integrate the veins into the flesh and how the texture affects. Yes, I can do a small demonstration of how I go about sculpting veins. I'll do one here on the tricep. Now with veins, they have to be really, really subtle. That's the trick. And also, if you're doing something that small, it's, you can imagine how small the vein worm has to be. So now I'm sure it's going to get dirty. I'll give it a try. Try to make it almost like hair thickness. And then, you know, I have in my mind pattern of thunder, lightning, you know, or roots, or our nervous system. All these things have the same pattern, which is the vein pattern as well. So I need to add veins. I'm doing it fast here just for demonstration purpose, but you need to take your time with it, as with everything else in sculpture, in order to get a nice result. I don't know if you can see there. And then you can blend them in the surface. Also, veins have to go in specific parts of the body, not everywhere, if you want to have a convincing effect. Or you can use in oil-based clay, I can use solvent with brass to blend it in, or fire sometimes. Sometimes I screw up the blending thing and it looks not so good. So again, I didn't. Thank you, Tom. I don't know which piece, because I keep changing the pieces in front of me, but thank you very much. I'm just reading some comments. Catherine Lewis about the technique called side loading. Oh, that's very interesting. I never heard of it or tried to do that, about the side loading. But I'm definitely going to give it a try. Thanks, Catherine. Yeah, Fulvio Komatsu, how do you think about your secondary and tertiary forms? My creatures end with smooth surface often and my wrinkles don't look too good. This again comes from observation. I continue work on each piece until it feels to my eyes like it has a level of believability or realism, you know. It's obviously something that doesn't exist, but I have to base the rib cage and the muscles of the chest in human anatomy, but just, you know, the basics. Then you can play with proportions, you can bend, stretch, enlarge and do different things with the forms once you put them in. So it's always a combination of real life elements and combining them and twisting them in a smart way to still look something like something familiar, but on the outside it's obviously not something that you can find in nature, but it has elements of nature. So especially for creature design and character design, which is mostly based on organic sculpting, not necessarily, but for me at least, I like organic sculpting. You see that I never sculpt a robot or a hard surface modeling. So I lost track of the answer. What was it? Oh, and for the wrinkles, again, you have to take account of the fact that there's weight. So to create the illusion of weight, I tend to smooth things down in a downward motion. So for instance, if I want to smooth these little forms here, I go like this, slightly, very little pressure. Also, how much pressure you put on your tools, depending on what you're doing, is another very important thing to keep in mind. Because it's not just what tool you're using, it's what angle you're using the tool against the clay, how much pressure you put, how much speed you use with each stroke, if it's fast, if it's slow, it's different. So basically every tool is capable of doing, you know, 100 different things, not just one thing. And if you keep experimenting with materials and tools and basically just experimenting, that's a very good way to keep learning stuff and happy accidents and all this kind of stuff. I'm reading the comment about the veins. Yes, for this one I was lucky, I guess, because sometimes I struggle with the veins. I struggle and I start, and when I start, I then say, oh fuck, I have to do the same on the other side, and if I put veins on the arms, then I feel like I have to put some on the legs, and so you see very rarely I use veins, and not too many of them. Barilla. Thank you, Giovanni. Yeah, Barilla is one of my favorites, although I start to see issues with certain angles of the piece. You know, for a sculpture to be good, really good, it has to be perfect and interesting looking from all 360 angles. So there are a few angles for this piece that I don't like, especially on the leg area. From knee and up, it's good. So there are areas still that I need to focus and work on my weaknesses, like ankles, feet, and hands. There's so much going on the hand anatomy with small forms that I need to study that more. Thank you, Jared. Janot Rios, it's a hard name to pronounce. Aeba Pinpin. Do you have times when your work is less awesome, when it's good but not up to your usual level? Yes, of course. There's a lot of that going on, and especially the way I work, where I don't have much discipline, in the sense that I say that I will sculpt this and I will stick to the plan. As I said, I keep making changes. And I follow my gut for a lot of stuff, which is not always the right thing to do, because sometimes I end up making a change for the worst, and then I lose, you know, I lose the excitement that I had and the interest. And sometimes it's better for me to start a new piece if this happens, or make radical changes. Oh, and another piece I forgot, which is another one of my favorites, but again it has issues with the proportions. not proportions, something's going with the leg. So this is oil-based clay, NSP medium, the brown one. And this, believe it or not, started as I made the armature based on a hippopotamus skeleton from a book. So I was planning to make a hippo, and you see what came out. After putting some clay on top of the armature, it started to look very not pleasant to me, I don't know. And I started playing, I got a little bit frustrated and lifted the armature up, opened the legs, and immediately I saw it also had a tail, because after the hippo I decided to make it a wolf-like, dog-like creature, so I added the tail as well. And this pose came about, and it reminded me of some when the lizards are fighting, Komodo dragons stand on their back legs, and I liked the pose, and immediately I found a new, the sculpture found its way to what it is now, so I added a longer neck later, and this is what the piece looks like now. I'll try to focus on the surface, because I have one side again detailed, but the other one is still with not so much skin texture, as you can see. And this piece I would really like to mold in order to paint it and finish it, but I'm already starting to think that I will definitely have to cut the arms. And I haven't made any keys, it's just a simple aluminum wire armature underneath. So, you know, this kind of stuff stops me from finishing and molding a piece. But I'm happy with the design to the musculature, at least on this side. So when I look the leg from this angle, I don't like it. Something's going wrong and I cannot pinpoint it, what it is, and this frustrates me. Same as this one. I don't like this angle. But anyways, yeah, it's another piece that I started relatively recently, and I don't like the front of the face. I'm reading comments now. Oh yes, books or YouTubers that you recommend, and also you should consider set up a Patreon. About the Patreon, I have already set up a page, but I haven't launched it yet, because I figured I have to make material for my Patreon page, which means I have to, every time I sculpt something or make something, to set up the camera like I have now. And it's not always easy, because when I work alone, I sometimes bring the whole piece in my chest, so I don't hunch all the time, and I work it like that. So the ideal thing would be to have someone to record me while I'm working the way I'm comfortable working. Otherwise, I would have to get out of my comfort zone and complete works with a setup like this that I have here, where the camera is basically between my arms. And I'm kind of stuck with the pattern. I don't know if I'm getting into something that will take all my time, because it's one thing to do the work that I do. It's another thing to record all that thing, upload it, edit, and put it on a pattern page. So that's why I'm stuck with the pattern. And I'm having trouble figuring out the tiers, I don't know how they call them, and all this kind of stuff. You know, I'm not too good with managing myself like that, my time. How many hours does it take to finish one of these, roughly? Yeah, because the time is another issue. A lot of times I work on many pieces at the same time, not exactly at the same time, but you know, I might work for 2 hours on this piece, then I want my eyes to get refreshed with something, so I leave this on the side, I bring a bust or something else, work another 2 hours, and I might do that with three or four pieces, because I have, as you see, a lot of unfinished pieces on the background. All the red stuff you see is plastiline still. So I can bring each one of these to the table and keep working on it. So I have a full 8 hours of work every day, and it's not necessarily on one piece. So it's a hard question to answer. Some pieces, from start to finish, the sculpture, if I do 8 hours straight on one piece, it could be done in 16 to 20 hours, depending on the complexity, the size, the material. You know, a lot of factors play a big role to answer this question. But usually, for instance, for this, to make the armature, it took me half an hour. To cover the armature with clay, it takes another half hour. And then start to add the basic muscles, takes about 1 to 2 hours. Very basic, you know, I already make them in my hand. I stick them in, I shape them with my hands, and then I use tools if I want to round them and be more precise. So yeah, it can vary from 20 hours to even months working on a piece, a little bit every day. Happy holidays, Basiri, the John. Thank you very much. I'm very happy when I hear that my work is inspiring other people to do sculpture or this kind of work. This is the best kind of compliment, because I know how much I got inspired from other artists when I was starting out. So I know exactly the feeling, and it's good, feels good. Thank you, Brett. Thank you very much. What kind of albums with animals, creatures, monsters do you recommend? I'm going to bring some books here to show you real quick, because the time is running out. It's almost 9:45. I have many, many books. Most of them are artists, other artists' work, nature, animals, plants, and making of books, like the behind the scenes from movies, how they make the designs and all that. It's hard to pick just a few, but I bring some that really helped me to learn anatomy, which is the animal anatomy, of course, and the human anatomy. I'll bring just three books for now, because it's a list. So this, very recently, I got as a present from JJ. Thank you very much, JJ. I appreciate it. It's amazing, pictures of skulls, which get me really inspired. Let me get some stuff. Because you can look at skulls from any angle you want, and with a little bit of imagination, you know, faces start to appear. So it has every kind of skull, amphibians, birds, mammals, reptiles, everything. And it's nicely lit. And just by looking at skulls, you know, I get so much inspiration about shapes, silhouettes, forms, everything. It's one of my best kind of reference. And also you get to learn how the muscles attach to the bones and how they work, so you learn the mechanics of what makes it work like it works. So this is one book, plenty of pictures inside, as you can see. And the book is, it's called Skulls, an Exploration of Alan Dudley's Curious Collection, from Simon Winchester. So this is one. Another one you, most of you probably already know, Atlas of Animal Anatomy for Artists. Really cool illustrations inside, from bats to rabbits, monkeys, seals, and then the usual cats, horse, all the layers of muscle, bone, fat, everything. It's an amazing book. Really helpful, especially for the cat section. When I was sculpting a lion, I remember using this. You can see how the skull fits into the muscles and all this interesting kind of stuff. So I like this picture. It's very helpful for me because I see how much all this space is just meat, how you say it. Yeah, this is another of my favorite books. I keep going back to this book every time I sculpt something because I like to incorporate animal anatomy into my sculptures. And this is another one for human anatomy, again with illustrations mostly, but has some really nice ones from Leonardo da Vinci, Michelangelo. And another book that I really, really got inspired, that also a gift, is this one. Of course, you know this guy. He's a genius, as well as Antoine, a French sculptor, Antoine Louis Barrier, I think it's called, which I just love how accurate the anatomy of his sculptures are and how expressive. All the forms are right, even though there's no skin textures or pores or anything, you know, it's just beautiful stuff, silhouettes, and I really get inspired by this book. I just flipped it two times already and I got so many ideas of things I want to sculpt, similar things to these, you know, like rough sculpture like this where you don't see any. That's why I love the Shiflett Bros work as well, because it's so alive, even though there's no the tiniest pores. And this is a good example to show you that what it's important for sculpture is the forms, mostly. The forms must work good from a distance. And then the detail is just a matter of what every artist wants to do, you know, because I want to add realism, I have to add the pores. And it's also like a OCD kind of thing where I want, if someone buys my work and brings it in front of his face, I want to not be able to see tool marks or fingerprints. It's just my style. But I also appreciate and love when people like the Shiflett Bros create such a lifelike work and so alive and fresh without the use of fine skin textures. And I admire that. I wish I could do it. I did it, I think, in Coco, the gorilla sculpture I showed you earlier. I restrained myself from putting pores into the face and all this stuff I usually do. I wanted to be more loose and more fresh. Because it's true that while you keep refining a piece, it loses some of the spontaneity, some of the, I don't know if it's the right word, the dynamism it has when it's just finger shapes. Do you interact with other Greek sculptors? Is there a local sculpting scene? There are a few here in Greece. I met with all of them. It's not a big sculpting scene here in Greece. I mean, I can count them in my fingers, in both hands. And they're really talented people, all of them, and really cool guys. But as I said, it's now with the growth of the internet and the information becomes available more and more widely, more and more people want to get into this stuff. And again, I get messages from people here in Greece as well to ask me how to begin, what to do, how to go about doing this for a living. So there are new people coming up as well. It's better than Santa workshop. Thank you, Christina. Yeah, it's a little bit of museum. It's where I do all my creative stuff. I also experiment with music in here. It's not just sculpting. Have a microscope so I can observe the really microscopic organisms. And again, I'm taking ideas for textures, shapes that you cannot see with a naked eye. And it's really inspiring for me. Hi, Peter. Yes, I'm well, thank you. A list of a few great reference things. I'm gonna bring, because we only have 5 minutes, I'll bring some pieces. So yeah, basically, JJ, not the second one. There are three different kinds of reference I brought here. Two of them are similar for, this is from June's Anatomy, amazing stuff. I read the information about this. It's sculpted on top of a scan, a 3D scan of a tiger, of an actual tiger skeleton. So one side you see the musculature, and the other side is as it looks with the skin on top, the veins. Also has the detachable head, so you can take it in front of you and study. Amazing detail. It also has a head with open mouth that I recently bought, and you can put this on here. So this is one, and if you check June's Anatomy website, you can see what else is in there. It's, I want everything from in that site. So it's a best kind of reference always is a 3D object. It's much better than copying from 2D pictures. This from Anatomy Tools. It helped me amazingly how much this helped me get a grasp of human anatomy. It's just the surface muscles. In some areas, it shows you what happens under the surface muscles. Like for instance, here you see a little, this side is a little different than this one, or the knee, for instance. This and this kind of reference, again, when I go in rivers and I find a lot of dead animals, I try to, if I find them in good condition, to preserve them and have the real thing for reference. And you get amazing information about textures, the colors, even though the colors are gone with this one. But yeah, just the... You can see this stuff gets me as inspired as anything could get me. I mean, who's a better creature designer than nature itself? And I try to copy nature as much as possible and steal from nature and incorporate some of this stuff in my sculpture. So you see again the little bumps like I do in the super sculpted piece, kind of like the same thing here. And now that I see this, I really want to copy this kind of legs for my multi-legged creature that I have here, which is more like I don't like the design of these legs, really. It's not spider legs, it's not mammal legs, I don't know what it is yet, but it's an early in the process, so still have time to. So yeah, it's 1 minute to close this. I have to announce now the next, I have to read all the comments once this is done. Thank you very much everyone for joining me. It was really good. The 2 hours just passed like it was nothing. It's crazy. Of course, the two next guests that are coming, first one is Miss Munster, amazing artist. I follow her on Instagram. With sculptural works, she does castings with really nice translucent materials with resin. You should definitely check her work out. And after Miss Munster is going to be Jordi Dussel. You know, everyone knows Jordi Dussel, a big influence for me when I was starting out, even now. And I'm really looking forward to check all the next Wednesday live sculpting sessions. Thank you, Brandon and Jarod, for inviting me once again. It was a pleasure. I hope you everyone enjoyed the live stream. Sorry if I didn't get the time to answer all the questions. I might try to answer the comments in written form. So yeah, that's a wrap. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Brandon and Jarod. Until the next time. Cheers.